This is News Talk 1590 KBTA. I'm Lynn Fairley, and this is the Lynn Fairley and Fabulous Friend Show. Oh my gosh, I was so thrilled it finally rained in Ventura County, and everything today is so fresh and clean and perky and lovely. I see happy faces and dirty cars. Didn't you enjoy that last night, Spence?
Yes, it was great. It was very nice to get the rain, and we got more than we thought we would.
Yeah.
You know, well over an inch in most areas, which is very surprising because it wasn't supposed to hit us, but it did, so that's good.
But the kids got to go out and trick-or-treat before it got to slip and slide.
Yeah, we didn't get any rain until about 10, so for all intents and purposes, the trick-or-treating for the little guys is over.
Well, I had my costume out, and I was all over the place last night. I had a good time at Squash Grapes. Thank you very much, you guys. Adam and Josh, what amazing place. If you haven't been to Squash Grapes, go. And then I went on over to the three stories of fun at the Watermark, where there was a huge Halloween party. And I just decided after a while it was too hot and too loud in there. So I just walked around in my costume on Main Street and got drenched, got wet, and it was just a whole lot of fun with a good friend of mine. Well, today, I had promised you last week that we were going to talk about the Veterans Court with Judge Colleen Toy White. We are going to tell you about Judge Colleen Toy White, but she appointed somebody very special to come and do that in her place because she's just not feeling 100% well today. And that's Kim Evans. Welcome very much, Kim Evans, to my show.
Thank you, Lynn, very much. I'm glad to be here.
Oh, yeah, she is. Look at this big smile. And she picked by Toby Keith the following song, courtesy of the Red, White, and Blue, as her favorite song.
American girls, American guys, we'll always stand up and salute. We'll always recognize when we see old glory flying. There's a lot of men dead, so we can sleep in peace at night when we lay down our head. My daddy served in the army. We lost his right eye, but he flew a flag out in our yard till the day that he died. He wanted my mother and my brother, my sister and me.
Wow, that's a great song, Kim Evans. I'm so glad you picked that one. Now, why? What does that talk? What does that say about your passion for what you do? And then tell our listeners what you do a little bit, just a snippet, because we're going to talk about Judge Colleen Toy White, then get back to you, okay?
It just personifies everything that I believe in and the work that I do with the veterans and the military community and sort of the lens that I look at the world through.
You know, me too. We share that very much. And most people know that I dedicate every single show to a veteran, and we'll get to that at the Veterans Minute. But first of all, thank you for your service in that regard.
Thank you.
Now, you were appointed by Judge Colleen Toy White, named Judge of the Year. Why? Why? Not. Don't tell us her personal issues, but tell us about her court nutshell version, and I will read something you gave me to read about Judge Colleen Toy White.
Well, Judge Colleen Toy White is amazing to work for. She is just such a strong advocate for so many different groups of people in Ventura County. And it's just an honor to work with someone who's such a fantastic mentor. Her passion is just unparalleled to help different groups that are in need.
And how do you know her in the first place?
I know her because I work directly for her. I am the community liaison for the Ventura County Veterans Treatment Court.
Perfect. And that's what we're going to talk about in just a second. But before that, I'm going to tell you about Judge Colleen Toy White. Judge Colleen Toy White has been named Judge of the Year by the Ventura County Trial Lawyers Association. The honor was bestowed at the association's 36th annual Judges Night Dinner on March 25th this year. The award recognizes exceptional judicial performance balanced with courtesy and compassion towards litigants and attorneys. Honorees are selected by committee comprised of a diverse group of trial lawyers committed to bettering the civil justice system, the lawyers who serve it, and the community it serves. Judge White has served as a Ventura Superior Court judge for 19 years. She is a past presiding judge and assistant presiding judge and a former supervising judge of the Family Law Division. Judge White was elected to the Superior Court bench in June 1994. She received a special appointment by Governor Wilson in November of that year, allowing her to take the bench prior to the start of her term in January 1995. Judge White has served on numerous state and local committees and task forces. She is the recipient of many awards for outstanding public service, leadership, and contributions to the legal system. Most recently, she was recognized by the Ventura County Mental Health Board for her leadership, service, and dedication to the Mental Health Court, and by the Gold Coast Veterans Foundation for her service as presiding judge of the Veterans Court. Judge White has also been an instructor for several Southern California colleges. Boy, she's busy. Now, we've had the Gold Coast Veterans Foundation on when Ron Greenwood came on, who's also a vet, by the way, a long, long time ago, and several other of the board members have been on to talk about the Gold Coast Veterans Foundation, probably one of the largest here in our area. Judge White initiated many of the Ventura Superior Court specialty court programs. These include Dependency Drug Court, which provides early intervention for newborns prenatally exposed to alcohol or drugs while strengthening the ability of families to care for their children. Elder Law Court, which uses a specialized approach to adjudicating complex elder abuse cases. Veterans Court, which we're going to talk about a lot today, which hears criminal cases involving veterans who suffer from the effects of combat-related psychological injuries or substance abuse. And Community Intervention Court, which helps offenders who are repeatedly cited for vagrancy-related crimes to get into treatment programs and off living on the streets. That's four separate courts. That's amazing. And that takes care of everybody, from newborns to the elder, to the vets, to the homeless. Wow. Judge White, thank you so much. We think you're listening, and we hope you are. If you want to call in and talk, you may. It's 805-650-1590. In fact, anybody may. Judge White also initiated the Pro Per Clinic, the forerunner of the court's Family Law Self-Help Center, which assists litigants representing themselves in the family law courts. That's not always easy. Prior to being elected to the bench, Judge White was a member of the Ventura County District's Attorney's Office for 18 years, 10 of which were in the position of Chief Assistant District Attorney, that agency's second highest position. Did she work with our friend District Attorney Michael Bradbury?
She did. And he was instrumental in starting the court as well.
Okay, yeah, that's right. I just remember that my two brain cells finally connected. We had him in recently, and what a treasure, because he did his cowboy poetry, and that was so much fun. Judge White is a graduate of the Ventura College of Law. Oh, that's where our Professor Claire Burrill teaches constitution law, and he does our constitution class here on my show, Lynn Fairley and Fabulous Friend Show. We try and teach everybody about their civic rights in the courts and so forth, and so he teaches there. She currently hears criminal matters in courtroom number 37, in addition to several of the specialty court calendars. Also honored at the event was retired Judge David W. Long. A formal portrait was unveiled and presented to the court by the Ventura County Trial Lawyers Association. The association has selected one judge annually for the honor of a portrait since 1978. Judge Long served for many years as the supervising civil judge, handling all the civil mandatory settlement conferences. Prior to his retirement, he heard misdemeanor arraignments and criminal trials. But the star of today's show is our lady, our lovely, lovely woman, who unfortunately couldn't be here. We really look forward to having her here, because we know she's going to be well. And that is Judge Colleen Toye White. First of all, thank you so very much for your amazing service. Amazing service. So she's appointed. My guest, Kim Evans, is going to tell us a little bit more about herself. Just a second. And then we'll talk a little bit more about the Veterans Court. So here's your lovely, beautiful Apple laptop back, from which I was reading all of that.
Thank you.
And I want to make sure that that's in good order. Okay. Kim Evans, where do you come from?
Where do I come from?
Yeah.
Originally, I came from La Beach, California.
And what did you study where?
Oh, I came from San Diego State University, landed up here for a job, and went to Pepperdine Graduate School for my master's in clinical social work.
So with clinical social work, you found a job here in our Veterans Court straight away, or did
you take a detour? I actually was a clinician in private practice for a very long time, and then was embedded with an Army National Guard unit out of Camp San Luis Obispo starting in 2006. I was a non-deployable asset, but I worked with them pre-deployment, post-deployment, during their deployment, and then for a few years after. And so continued doing private practice while I did that, and then landed back down here with the 146th Airlift Wing as their director of psychological health. And then I left that position last year to devote most of my time to the court here.
Fascinating. Wow, what a great track. On the way in, because of all kinds of different little sort of things, we ran into tiny obstacles this morning. She told me there's something that she learned in the military called Semper Gumby. Now, what does Semper Gumby mean?
It means blessed be the flexible.
I love that. Gumby, of course, that character, the green character, is so flexible. Mm-hmm. Yes, I love that. So Semper Gumby has been sort of our motto this morning, but you wouldn't know it because everything is coming off quite well.
Exactly.
All right. And so when you first got to the court, what happened?
Well, I actually started volunteering in the court a few years ago when it first started up. And at that point in time, I was just sort of sitting along the back wall of the case conference team. And since then, last year when I left the 146th, I was graciously appointed the community liaison for the court and given grant funding by a private grant donation from the Smith Foundation. And thus, my career began at the Ventura County Superior Court Veterans Treatment Court.
Wow, you've been in the right place at the right time, but you're also very bright.
Thank you.
Because you get yourself in the right place, and then, yeah, it all comes together. We have a call. Tom Spence, my producer, is on the phone that you may or may not be able to hear in the background. And I'm trying to learn whether or not we're going to put that person on the air. Yes, and who is on the phone?
We have Rod on the phone with a question about the court.
Oh, good. Ron, hi. Rod, thank you very much for calling the Lynn Fairley and Friends show. Where are you calling from, Rod?
Actually, I'm calling from Costa Pacifica. We just finished an event here with some of the children on the road to independence. But I understand that Judge White and Kim Evans may be guests of yours.
Well, Judge Colleen Toy White was to be my guest today, but she's a little bit under the weather on her way to recovery. And in her place, she appointed Kim Evans, who was just speaking a minute ago, who is very much her right hand and representing the court. I understand, Rod, you are a public defender?
I am. I'm a public defender, and I actually work with Ms. Evans and Judge White in the Veterans Court program.
Oh, good. Well, thank you so very much for calling. Rod, did you have a question for Kim?
Yes. Ms. Evans, how do you anticipate that there will be an expansion or a decrease in the number of veterans that will require services of the Veterans Court over the next year or two?
Well, Rod, as we're finding out in the court right now, we our triple capacity of what our original goal was for our Veterans Treatment Court. And at this point in time, there's a few individuals on our case conference team, specifically probation and then my position, which are funded for part-time positions. And we're at triple capacity now, and we know that there are approximately 60 to 80 veterans a day coming in through the jail who are self-identifying as having served in the United States military. Right now, we have no capacity to outreach to them, other than hoping that they find their way to Veterans Court. But we are definitely beyond capacity at this point in time, and additional funding will only help us to expand the program because we're doing good work there, as you well know.
And do you have any idea if there's anything in the works to expand the program as far as resources go for probation and for your position?
Well, we're really hopeful that we can get some grant funding that is out there. We know that there are a few grants that we may be able to avail ourselves of, but that's sort of something right now that's up in the wind. We need to get a whole lot of people together in order to have that happen for the court, and we're just hopeful with our fingers crossed because the more funding means the more people that we are then able to serve.
Well, I wanted to thank you very much. I know how hard you work to serve all the veterans of Ventura County, and Judge White has just been a tremendous asset to the Veterans Court, and we wouldn't have the Veterans Court without you and Judge White.
Thank you, Rod.
Rod, wow. Thank you very much for your call. I really, really, really appreciate it, and we appreciate what you do, too. You're awesome.
Thank you very much. You all have a great day.
Stay tuned to KVTA 1590. Thank you. Wow, that was a nice call. Very nice. I'm surprised to hear a couple of things. So we're going to have to back up a little bit. Well, let's just start talking about Veterans Court since we can make that segue now. You said 60 to 80 people self in a week or a month?
A day.
I thought I heard that wrong. A day. So 60 to 80 people come to you a day and self-identify. They say, I'm a vet. How do you check that out?
When you check into the jail, you're asked if you've ever been served, if you've ever served in the United States military. And we then get a list the next morning saying that depending on the day of the week, Fridays and Saturdays, we get more people in. But anywhere between 60 and 80 are self-identifying as having served in the military. Thus, that means at the very least, we should be taking a look at their case up at courtroom 37 on Thursdays at 2:00, which is Veterans Court. We are not getting all of them. We have not outreached to the jail in order to talk to the people directly because we simply don't have the staffing in place to be able to do that.
So that's what he was talking about, how you can expand this and meet this need. Because would you say, what's the percentage of people who self-identify, and I imagine they're men and women, who are actually, let's say, eligible?
There's a lot of discussion about that. For some individuals, they may not want to self-identify, those who are in the active duty National Guard and Reserve currently. And Veterans Court can be beneficial for them, but they may not want to identify because they may not want anyone from command to know what is going on with them in the jails. On the other end, we do not know of the 60 to 80 that are identifying how many of them actually have served in the military, or we really just don't know because we haven't had the resources to go in and check.
Wow, so this is a daily problem. So, gosh, you have a big hurdle to tackle there right at the front door, and that is to sort it out and get it right and have a way to check their ID but keep it anonymous and private. Wow, that's going to be hard.
Absolutely.
Oh, my. Okay, and they're there because they have committed a crime of some kind, whether it's minor or major, and they want to go through your system, which is once a week, versus going through what our known legal system does. And the benefit they get from doing that is?
The benefit they get from coming into Veterans Court is multifold. Veterans Court is considered a treatment court versus an incarceration court. So we will be sending individuals to treatment. Depending on the level of their offense, it might be something as simple as going to outpatient treatment at the Ventura Vet Center once a week for substance abuse or individual counseling for PTSD. Or then we also put veterans down at residential treatment at the VALA for inpatient treatment for chronic substance abuse issues, for chronic PTSD, coupled with substance abuse issues, that type of thing. So we do a treatment modality, and then they're there with us for about 12 months. It's not an easy program. The benefits are huge, however. The fines and fees are stayed while they are in treatment court with us. Once they successfully complete the requirements of our court, the fines and fees are waived, with the exception of victim restitution. The records are expunged for the cases that we are seeing in the court, and then we can move to seal them as well. So for our individuals who are looking for employment, jobs, additional opportunities, this is a huge value. There are some things that make it maybe not for everyone, one of which is you have to plead guilty before you come into the court. Thus, we do the expungement and the sealing on the other end. You are placed on formal probation. Not all the offenses we see you would have a formal probation officer for. So like I tell our veterans, you're going to have a bunch of people kind of in your business for about a year. And if that's not something that you want, then it may not be the right court for you. We offer a whole lot of things, and we can talk about all the programs that come along with it.
Yeah, sure. Yes, we will. What's amazing to me, though, is that this is their second chance. Just if they go through this and come out the other end, case expunged, fees stayed, everything's sealed, they're delivered, they can go out and get a job. What if they fall off the wagon and they go back and they commit another crime? What, did they get another chance to go through it, or is this just a one-shot second chance?
Generally speaking, it's a one-shot chance. We have a very low recidivism rate. One of the things that, because of our funding, we're not able to track is kind of the back end. So what happens to our veterans when they leave the court? The entire time that I have been with the court, I've seen one veteran return, and that's been in the last 3.5 years. So just in very unscientific data, I would say our program does incredibly well. We give so many different tools. So if they're in residential treatment and they come back to Ventura, we place them back at the vet center here, so they have continued care if needed in the community. We also offer HUD VASH is available at the court, which is the housing vouchers for veterans who have been homeless. We have Employment Development, who's just come on board. They're there every week with us to help with jobs for veterans. We have Mike McManus from the Veterans Service Office.
Yay, our buddy Mike McManus.
And he helps all our veterans with their benefits. We have HSA, which brings out CalFresh and any Medi-Cal benefits, because some of our service members and veterans actually qualify for both. So we're doing this just wraparound of care. Our mentor program also connects with the veterans every week. So we are trying to just at every Thursday make sure that we have a community there that really outreaches. We have fantastic partners.
I'd love to just sit and be the fly on the wall one Thursday. Just park me in the corner. I stand.
Absolutely.
And just watch and see what's going on. I would love to be invited to watch this, because this sounds like it's highly functional and maybe a model for how all of our courts should be run.
Absolutely. It's a wonderful thing.
Absolutely amazing. Now, this app must grow. Yes, Rod, thank you very much. This must grow. You need grant money. My goodness, your probation officers have got to be just overloaded, because they're already overloaded from AB 109. So their paperwork tripled at that point, and so they must be overwhelmed. You need way more probation officers, I would imagine, never mind parole.
Yeah, we have one probation officer assigned to the court, and this is a collateral or ancillary duty for her. So I believe she has 110 or 120 cases total, with 44 current veterans from our court, and then 17 pending right now. So she's stretched.
She's on an IV caffeine drip,
yes.
I think. Well, we need to honor her. What's her name? Let's thank her for what she does.
Her name is Officer Patty Ortiz.
Oh, I think I know Officer Patty Ortiz. Yeah, we'll let her know that we thank her officially for handling that caseload. She's the only one for the court?
She's the only one for our court.
Isn't somebody going to rally for a second one at least?
We are working on that right now, but any help that we can get with that, we would greatly appreciate it.
Oh my gosh, that's incredible. Do you only get money by grant, or do you have fundraisers? Do you have a way to donate? Do you have a website? Let's talk about that before the break.
Right now, we do not have a mechanism in place. The nonprofit that I lead, the Ventura County Military Collaborative, is very close to being a certified nonprofit. We have our number, but we're not quite there yet. I believe with the permission of Judge Choi White, once we get to that point, then we can start taking donations to assist the court as well. Gold Coast Veterans is handling the grant from the Smith Foundation for my position right now as well, and it is something that we can do some outreach for. There is the Ventura County Military Collaborative website, and all of our programs are at military411.org, and those are the numbers 411 and then .org. So you'll see all sorts of information on all sorts of different things.
Well, that's
there.
A good, clean, easy to remember website. That's fantastic. Wow, how exciting. Is this the only veterans court so far, and is it a model court that's kind of a trial run that could spread to all the rest of the courts in the nation, never mind California?
There are other courts in the state of California. Orange County is used frequently as a model. We have some different nuances in our court. We do see the active duty guard and reserve component, which other courts, we've not heard that they are doing that. So we have a very nice relationship with the base, and that's something that's going to put us on a completely different trajectory than the other courts in the state of California right now.
Excellent. And will this spread across the nation?
It is spreading across the nation. One thing we do not have is there are no federal or state regulations or rules as far as what veterans court looks like. Mm. So all the veterans courts are run Orange County. You can be a violent felon and be able to come into veterans court. In Ventura County, we see nonviolent felonies and lower. And in Los Angeles, they don't see misdemeanors. So your first time DUIs, you can't be seen in L.A. It's all very different, and there's no particular order to it. It's just each county decides.
Wow. This is huge, and this is history, and you're making it up as you go along here. This is American history, courtesy of the red, white, and blue. Excellent, Kim Evans. This is very interesting. At this time in my show, we take a little break. What we're going to do is the Veterans Minute, and you must have a veteran or a whole bunch of veterans. How about this? Because you also head up something you're going to dash off to and do right after the show, and that's moderate what?
I'm moderating a panel at the Camarillo Library for military spouses, so we can get an understanding of what it's like to be a military spouse.
That's got to be a lot of fun. So let's thank all the military spouses for the Veterans Minute. Let's do that.
That's
all right?
Fantastic.
Okay, so we do that with the Shoemaker's song right now. Thank you.
with a dancing girl. Fell so hard that it rocked my world. Headed off to a place in Iraq, and that man that she loved never made it back. Take me out on a starry night.
Butterfly. All right, you know, I always thank the veterans for their service, because America will never forget their service. They're courageous. And, you know, and their fear, Mark Twain wrote something about fear. It's not the absence of fear that courage stands for. Rather, it's being able to embrace fear, handle fear, hold fear, and still take that next step. That I just blew Mark Twain's entire quote, and I'll get it right next time. But I think it's got to be so hard also for the spouses of the military to wave goodbye to their spouse for 6 months, 9 months, a year, or whatever, and know that they're going to be deployed in the middle of the fight in someplace horrendous, some Ickistan. I call all those Ickistans over there because they're Ickistans. And we have one recently who left us. He was the commander, ex-captain commander of our naval base, Todd Fowler. He also went. He was the chaplain, but most recently Todd Cowpie was his nickname. His last name, do you remember? Oh, my gosh,
no.
Todd. Goodness, he was just on the show, too, pilot. He's been deployed 10 times, and he just got deployed out to Ickistan in Bahrain. And I've been talking to his wife, who's just heartbroken and afraid and so tired of being deployed, so tired of dragging her family around, so tired of those little kids having to get up and move and pack and not being consistent schooling and so forth. She said, you know, I'm done. I'm not going on number 10. I am just not going over to Ickistan with you. I'm staying here in Camarillo, and it's a very big stance she took finally. And I really admired that, because she's afraid for him. She won't see him for a long time, and neither will the children. But it must have taken a lot for her to say, no, no more. I'm staying home. So are those the kind of things you talk about with the spouses?
Yeah, very, very challenging job of being a spouse, because while your loved one is deployed, you have to run everything back at home. And depending, we're coming up on the holidays. So for spouses who have their loved ones deployed now, it's going to be an incredibly difficult time, because it seems like when your husband or wife is gone, that it appears that everyone in the entire world is together, with the exception of you and your family. And so spouses, we're a tough group. You know, my thing is, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And inevitably, literally, as soon as my husband left, our dog ate our entire sprinkler system. So I learned how to rewire our sprinkler system.
A little separation anxiety here.
But you become incredibly strong, and you deal with things that normal people usually don't have to deal with. And but I think it also creates a part of you that is quite impressive and can really show you that you can do anything that you want as a military spouse, because look what you've accomplished so far.
Excellent. So you've got grit and you've got Gumby on your side.
Absolutely.
Todd Watkins, Commodore Todd Watkins. That's the person who was just deployed. I also want to let you know that Max Vanderwick, everybody knows Max Vanderwick, one of our oldest veterans, if not the oldest in our community. It might be one older. He's a merchant marine, actually. I know who he is. His 95th birthday party is November 20th from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Save this date at the Internet Cafe inside the Victoria Care Center, where Max is in room 37. He holds court and cocktail parties over there in room 37, because he's, you know, he was the model for the Energizer Rabbit. He's still going. He had a stroke. He recovered from the stroke. The only thing that's still numb, I think, is his left hand. And he's sitting there, and he's laughing, that laugh Max has. But we're having a 95th birthday party for him, so drop in for happy hour. Say hello. Have some hors d'oeuvres at the Internet Cafe on November 20th from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. I'll remind you some more, because Max is an icon here, particularly in our military world. He's done more for the vets, actually, than anybody has. And I would challenge anybody to find the person who's done more. You're on your way. You're almost there.
Thank you.
Kim Evans is my guest today on the Lynn Fraley and Fabulous Friend Show. I got to tell you a couple more things. I saw something really amazing at the Rubicon Theater Company. It's called Two Pianos, Four Hands, and I really, really recommend this. It seems like from the flyer, if you see it around, you've got two guys with two beautiful classical pianos sitting back-to-back on the stage at the Rubicon. and it looks like a concert. It is not play. It's absolutely stunning. They run around and they do this entire play about, it's hilariously funny production. It features these two actors, two pianos, and a multiple of characters as they have 15 years of piano playing. And what they do is they talk about their crazy instructors, their obsessed parents, their torturous recitals, and other high points of musical training. And they are accompanied by all the wonderful musical selections you want to hear, ranging from classical pop to jazz, Beethoven, Bach, Elton John, Jerry Lee Lewis, and others. It's really fun. It's playing right now at the Rubicon Theater through November 16th. I highly recommend this. The performances are Wednesdays through Sundays. Through November 16th, and that's at the RubiconTheater.org or in our area, code 667-2900, 667-2900. It's a blast. These guys are very, very talented and very funny, and they run around the stage. They don't stay seated at those pianos. They're all over the place, and it's just as good as it gets. So that's what's going on at the Rubicon. Let's see. Also, my gosh, what an amazing week, because last Monday, Claire Burrell, the attorney from the College of Law, and I, we went to UCSB and we listened to Erwin Chemerinsky, who is an author of a book called The Case Against the Supreme Court. Just fascinating. He was a student of Lawrence Tribe, another really famous author who wrote a book recently. We featured him on our Legal Clarity segment. But this is just the opposite. This is about what is wrong with the Supreme Court. And he gave a lot of examples about all the cases that they've tried through many, many, many decades. So it's not just this particular Supreme Court he's talking about. It's just the whole design of the court and the function of the Supreme Court and what's wrong with it and what needs to be changed. That was Monday. Then we really lucked out. And on Thursday, we got invited to the Cal State University sort of private ceremony and public speech for Justice Sandra Day O'Connor. What a national treasure. Of course, most of you know Justice Sandra Day O'Connor. Was the very first woman appointed to the Supreme Court in 1981 by Ronald Reagan and served for 25 years and ended her term in 2006. And she hasn't stopped going. She's 85 years old, walked on after we had kind of a private little book signing and chit-chat and hors d'oeuvre cocktail party with her. She walked on stage to address the public and couldn't have been funnier. She was just so candid and so full of humor and knowledge. I think all of us could have sat and watched that for hours on end. It was incredibly entertaining. So Justice Day O'Connor's on a roll. She started something called iCivics. It's small I civics, so iCivics, and that's a .org. Check that out, because that's a really popular program that's growing. It's 2 years old. They had 2 million students looking at it just this last month. They have 40,000 schools that are involved in it. And what they're doing is taking iCivics. They're little games that kids play. And they could be, 6 to 16 or older. It's even fun for adults, because I went on to play the games for a little bit. And there's these things that teach you about civics, what it means. What is civic duty? Now, as a kid, my dad taught me civic duty this way. He said, you're going to have to go down, and for the lady down the street who is let's say she was an invalid, okay, and I was 9 at the time. He says, you're going to take her trash cans from the street and put them back into her yard every single time the trash service comes. And you're going to do that anonymously. You're going to do that for no allowance. You're going to do that because that's your civic duty. You're a kid that can walk around, and you've got too much energy, so you're going to spend it doing some civic duty. And I did. And it took her probably a year to figure it out, because since my dad told me at the age of 9 I had to do it anonymously, I tried so hard for her not to see me. I thought part of the job meant she could never, ever see me. So it was this big secret agent thing. Like, I would put on a hat and a sweatshirt hood, and I'd run over there and dash. And if I saw her looking out the window, I'd have to run away and wait and then try and do the second can. I didn't realize for a while that if she saw me accidentally, that was okay. So those are civic duties, and those are the type of things kids need to learn how to do for their community. And on iCivics, there's a lot of little games to play so that they understand what that means. Yes. The other thing I want you to read is The Oath by Jeffrey Toobin. If you are ever interested in courts and courts in general, This is the best-selling author of The Nine, which and that explains the nine people who are currently on the court. But this is about Obama's White House and the Supreme Court, the Kennedy Court. It's called The Oath. If you remember when Obama was sworn in, they bungled the oath, the two of them. And that's why it's called The Oath. Great read if you're interested in courts. Our topic today is our local court, the Veterans Court, and the star of the show, who couldn't be here, is Judge Colleen Toy White. So for those of you just tuning in, let's just recap a little bit about Judge Colleen Toy White and some of the things you were starting to touch on about the various programs in the Veterans Court that you are very much a part of, Kim Evans.
Thank you. So Judge Toy White could not be here today, and so I'm here in her stead, and I am the community liaison for Veterans Treatment Court. The Veterans Treatment Court is set up with a model of treatment versus incarceration. So we are all about counseling, inpatient treatment, outpatient treatment. We do, however, have to have a nexus between your military experience and the crimes that you are charged with. I'm a clinician, so one of the things that I know is, generally speaking, alcohol or substance abuse can go hand in hand with post-traumatic stress disorder. It's a pretty easy nexus for us. Where we have a difficult time is some of our veterans who did not serve in a combat zone and trying to make that nexus for them. What I recommend for everyone, though, who is a veteran or has served in the United States military, is to ask their public defender or ask at the court to have their case calendared on Thursdays at 2:00 for Veterans Treatment Court. So we, as a case conference team, can take a look at their particular situation. I do an intake with every individual that comes into our court, so we are well aware of their particular circumstances. And then Rod Codman, who you just spoke with, he's our public defender for our court. He then also talks with them as well, and he has a great team that does amazing work for the veterans in the community.
So you by yourself are the first, you're the lion at the gate?
I am the lion at the gate. I'm right there, front and center.
So you'll determine right there on the spot if you've got somebody probably, because they're self-identifying, probably eligible.
Yes. Well, I'll do an intake for them on the first day that they come to court, and then we will automatically have them return in 2 weeks. And when they come back in 2 weeks before they come into the court, the case conference team will meet before the 2:00 court calendar and determine as a group. So probation has a spot at the table, whether they can take them in on probation. Our public defender's there, our district attorney's there. So we have a look at, are the offenses too egregious? Have they done a felony? So if you did a DUI with great bodily injury, you're not going to be able to come into veterans court. So we all have a discussion, and sometimes they're very lively discussions. VA is also at the table, so they let us know if the person has ever registered for VA benefits before. A lot of our veterans have not registered for benefits. So we find that they have maybe 10 to 25% of the population is registered with VA, but a significant portion has not.
Yeah, that's mind-blowing for me that so many veterans haven't. So that 75% perhaps have not. And they don't know it's free, and the benefits are wide and huge. I don't understand how that falls through the cracks, that we can't get them all registered for their benefits. They deserve them.
I think a lot of it is pride. I know my husband, we've 26 years now, and he's a reservist for the Navy, and he did not register for VA benefits until last year, because reservists can register for VA benefits if they've deployed under an OEF, OIF, so Iraq, Afghanistan deployment. They are then considered combat veterans, and they can start their VA benefits immediately. They don't have to wait till they get out. But for my husband, he was concerned about how it would impact his military career, and he's also one of our guys, and we have a ton of them that say, I'm fine, I don't need it. Other people need it more than I do. And for us, if you are rated 0% or higher by VA, the state of California will pay 100% of the tuition for your children to go to any Cal State or UC school system. So that's a huge benefit for us as a military family.
Just that alone, never mind how many more?
Yeah, medical benefits, mental health benefits, there's everything. Even if you've served as a peacetime veteran and you had an honorable discharge, you are eligible for free inpatient residential treatment for any type of substance abuse issue, alcohol or drug-related, at VALA. And you don't ever have to have been in combat. So there's huge benefits out there for people.
Well, I'll endeavor to help trying to get the news out right here on News Talk 59 at KVTA, because I don't get that. I would think that that would be 101. In other words, the minute you're enlisted, the hand your brother shirt that says, here's what you do when you get out. Doesn't that seem like that should be in the packet?
They do that now. They have what was called TAPS courses, and they've changed the acronym on me, and I can't remember what the new one is. But they actually do have almost week-long courses to let people know what their benefits are. We have a couple of impediments to that. One is which sometimes people just want to get out, and they don't care what their benefits are. They're done with the military. They just want to get as far away as possible, as quickly as possible.
Sure. Well, I understand that. But they don't they understand how much their benefits can do for their children, themselves, the education you just mentioned, medical care later in life?
Some of them are young. That's another big issue. If you're 26 years old, I mean, you may not particularly care about what your health benefits will be, or, you know, you feel young and strong and you just want to leave the military and go on with your life. And so it's not something that they stick around to hear a lot about. We've had much discussion with spouses about it because they are not always privy to the information as well. And spouses are huge advocates for their loved ones in the military, as are parents. Parents are a very big up-and-coming group as far as advocating for their children who are in the military, adult children who are in the military.
Well, that's excellent, because the benefits never expire.
Right.
So if the person is 26, finally finds out at 46 he wants to educate his kid for free or get medical care for himself or maybe a spouse, then he can go back and say, by the way, at 26 I was in Ikistan and I would like to reapply.
Yes, it's much harder later on because you have to prove that these injuries actually caused some kind of impaired you in some way over the last 20 years. So if you hurt your back, you know, when you were 26 and now you're 48 and you've had no treatment for your back for the last 22 years, the VA is going to look at that and they're going to say no.
Oh, right. Yeah, because they've been in fender benders and
right.
Fallen off their bike
right.
Between now and then.
But
all the more important to let them know. But here's the other thing that we find out about PTSD, and my brother is 100% disabled with PTSD, and he was one of those guys, the I'm fine guy. It's a silent and unseen injury.
Absolutely.
And until a lot of these mental issues become they're impairing you or impairing him, as it were, did we start to recognize that, gee, you know, this is something that he needs help with, and finally get him some help, and he's doing very well now. But it was a long, long, long struggle. And how hard is it for a man or a woman who's got that I don't know, the grit and the courage to go into the military, and they've got that pride of being strong and, oh, well, no, I'm fine. The other guy needs it more than me. And they have that service-oriented type of personality. Now to come back and sit down about their problems. Who does that? Who goes from that person to, oh, no, I'm really needing your help person? That's that little transition, that bridge to get them to sit down and be completely just, it goes against their grain, I would say, to sit down and say, no, I'm not doing well. I am feeling a little weak.
Right.
Whereas they're supposed to be strong.
Right. You're absolutely right. I mean, one of the things that the military is doing incredibly well is they're deploying all of these clinical assets. So all these clinicians are being embedded into different units. So we then get to be sort of the face, the front line of really being able to explain to people, because the other part for our service members is they don't know what it is that's going on with them. They know they came back and they know they're different, and that's all they know. And then they start drinking and they push away everybody who loves them, and because it's too hard. It's literally too hard. And that's the great thing about Veterans Court, is because there's this whole population that we as service providers in the local area, we don't see them. But the first time DUI people that we're seeing at Veterans Court, they are hemorrhaging. So these veterans are coming in from a first time DUI, they're unemployed, they're divorcing or divorced, their family has left. And I had one guy who told me, I wake up every night thinking, what do my kids think about the fact that I failed them? Because his wife left with them. And it's tragic, but I can look him in the eye and tell him, we can help you with this. And I believe that to the core of my being. So it's a fantastic program, because we get to help people at the part where they don't think there's any help at all. And so it's great. And that's why it's amazing.
Yeah, there's a sad statistic. Over 22 vets a day commit suicide.
Yes.
And we give out the crisis line here often on my show, almost every single show. But you have so many more resources. And we've got Mike McManus and all the rest of you heroes out there to help as well. Is there a resource right now you'd like to talk about, a phone number and or a website, where someone who right this minute might need help, or it's a family member, or it's a neighbor, or it's a spouse who doesn't know where to turn, or who's in that sort of that tricky on the fence moment, tell them where to go right this minute.
I would say right now, I would be more than happy to talk with anybody about where they're at. I, as the director of the Ventura County Military Collaborative, there's 140 community-based agencies that come together once a month to talk about issues with veterans. So you can contact me at 805-218-1930, or you can go to the military411.org site, and I would be more than happy to direct you to whoever the best person is in our local community, or your statewide benefits, or Mike McManus with your VA benefits, that type of thing. But there is help out there, and we're all military. I like to say we're veterans helping veterans, and that's our goal. So if I can help, if you want to come and help us with our little noble mission of helping other veterans in the community, or if you feel like you would like to give back to this community, please contact me as well.
That's 805-218-1930. This is our hero today. You're awesome, Kim Evans. You're awesome. It's amazing how much dedication you have had for so many years, and you're just getting bigger and better. I mean, this is expanding. I can see you sitting here on this show in a couple of years telling us that you've doubled the capacity of the Veterans Court.
Thank you.
I really look forward to that. And that Judge Colleen Toy White is well and happy and still there pounding that gavel and having lively conversations with you.
Absolutely.
So please let her know, and we'll give you a copy of the show, as a matter of fact, for her to listen to, because I think it'll be very important for her to hear this, and if she is at the moment, and if anyone else out there would like to make a comment or call in, it's 805-650-1590. You can ask Kim some more questions. Now, the thing you're about to moderate in Camarillo, where is it and what time is it? And can the public come to that, or is that a closed sort of a community?
It's absolutely open to the public. It's at the Camarillo Public Library on Las Posas Road, and it starts at 2 p.m. It goes for an hour, and there will be a panel of military spouses, and I will be the moderator. And we're just going to discuss such things as, you know, how they've made it through their deployments with their spouses being gone, what it's like to raise children. Some of them have been in the military themselves and are now spouses staying home when their husbands deploy out. So it should be a very, very interesting panel. And just honestly, if anyone also feels like they want to come and connect with some of us, please feel free to come by. It's free. And the libraries this month, all of the libraries received some grant funding to reach out to military and veterans as well in the community.
You know where that library is located?
It's on Las Posas, but I don't know the address.
Okay, Public Library Camarillo.
Yeah, it's Camarillo.
Google. Yeah, all right. Well, you can get there and join them, and it's free. You know, this what you mentioned about losing family is really significant, because in a sense, for several years, we lost my brother, because he was very much alone and very much isolated and helpless and hopeless, and you go through that type of anxiety. Too proud to say he had a problem. Too proud to get help. The kind of guy that said, no, someone else needs it more than I do, would go and sit with homeless vets on the street and encourage them to go get help, but wouldn't get help for himself. That kind of person, because they are service-oriented, are wonderful people that do serve in many capacities. So we lost him for a little while, and he lost his marriage and his home and all of that. It's come back full circle, and everything's fine now. But that must be one of the hardest things for them to go through, and that is to go off. We don't even have the ticker tape parades anymore, or the community send-offs and the community welcome backs. You know, you don't have to like the policy. You don't have to like that we're at war. And war is a fact of life, and it has been way too long, way too many eons. And we hope that we change that slowly and slowly as we become one world. But the fact is, we're still there. Right. Regrettably, we are. But the people that do volunteer, by the way, they are not drafted. The people raise their hand to say, I'll go fight for your freedom. And then they come back. The wife's left. Kids are gone. Families all spread out. Then they face divorce. Then they can't find a job. And they're standing strong and they're standing tall saying, gee, I would really like to work for you, and it doesn't work, and then they start drinking, and they start disappearing and start isolating. This is, to me, the travesty of the whole system right there. So would you agree that we need this community welcome back, community send-off, and more of these community sort of relationships so that someone can land back here on their feet, and we can take them and say, thank you very much for what you've done and what you volunteered to do. Have a seat. We're going to talk to you about all kinds of things you might need.
Absolutely. I think the more that we can do as a community to kind of bring together the safety net of care in Ventura County, that's really been sort of our goal from the get-go. Is we know that for PTSD, the two signature traits are numbness and avoidance. So, and we've talked a lot about families and spouses and children, but there's so many single service members returning, male and female, back home. And sometimes the ticker tape parade can backfire because you'll go out. When my unit returned to Camp Slow, we had 40 young men and women left at the base once the commander and the first sergeant and everyone else had driven away and the barbecues were over, and no one had come to pick them up.
Oh my gosh. So that's what I mean right there. So the community
could
be there to pick them up.
Right.
We'd have a community bus. Somebody amazing, give us a van or two.
Absolutely.
Like the Calvet home, and load all those single people into the van and take them where they need to be. Find out what they need. Maybe they don't even know where to go.
Right.
But at least start with listing them for their benefits right then and there. So make sure that all those single men and women are picked up and are cared for. That's a gap we need to fill.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, Spence, who's awesome, just gave me the address of the Camarillo Public Library. So Kim Evans is about to go. She's going to need a police escort. I'm going to bounce her out of here pretty soon, within minutes. So she's going to get in her car and drive carefully to 4101 Las Posas Road in Camarillo. That's the public library there. It's located on Las Posas Road and Fieldgate Drive in Camarillo. Thank you very much, Spence. That's what right now is going to happen to you in like T-minus a few minutes, because you're going to go moderate. This group with a group of spouses are going to sit together and discuss very many of the issues we just did here on News Talk 1590 KBTA. I'm Lynn Fairley. Please tell Judge Colleen Toye White we missed her today, but we look forward to having her back and thank her very, very much for starting the Veterans Court in our area.
I will, absolutely, and thank you.
Oh, it's been a pleasure to have you on. I really look forward to getting to know you a little bit better.
Absolutely.
Thanks again.
Thank
now,
you.
Drive carefully and don't run off with the headphones on your head.
I will, thank
All
you.
All right. Here we go. Spence, you're going to play a little promo for us and a good rockin' song out.
Yes, we have Stevie Ray Vaughan to take us out, and I'd like to mention that a friend of your show, Malcolm McDowell, is going to be on at 3 o'clock today doing a lot of voice work, hosting a Halloween special that we've run over the weekend, and it's called Sleepy Hollow, The Lost Diaries. He does an amazing job. He's been on your show a couple of times. What a nice man, generous man, and he did this just on his own time to entertain the locals with Sleepy Hollow, and that'll be at 3 o'clock and also at 6. But catch it at 3, catch it both times. Very entertaining.
Did he come in and do that live?
They actually got to go to his house record it there, and they said that was terrific, and he was a great host and a very generous man.
Malcolm McDowell's amazing, and he is a good friend of mine. Tune into that. That'll be fun because his voice is so specific. It's so perfect for Sleepy Hollow. How fun.
Yeah, it's. I heard the promo, and I thought, okay, there you go. He's top of his craft.
He is. Well, thank you very much for that. All the more reason to stay tuned to 1590 KVTA. Stick duct tape on that. Never move it. All right. Thank you again, Kevin. Goodbye. We'll be right back.
looking back in front of me, the mirror's a grin.